Help me in welcoming Vinod Khosla.
Thanks, Amar. Thank you for coming
today. Welcome. Thanks.
So we'll move it. Yeah. It's all yours.
Go ahead. Good morning, everybody. Rajendra, could I grab that bottle of water just right down the side? Thanks. It's great to be here. And in fact, Rajendra set it up perfectly. $750 billion would be a very large part of the Indian economy, a very, very large part. But I want to tell you today that it can be done. My one message is large shifts happen all the time. What's necessary to make them happen is risk-taking. And with risk-taking comes failure. So my message is very simple. You can look at all the experts who predict markets and forecasts for 2020, but extrapolating the past is now not something that works, and I hopefully will try and prove it. Once people reject expert opinion, punditry about how the world will work, once you reject that, you can go on and start talking about inventing the future you want. That's why it's so encouraging to see so many hands come up when Sharad asked how many people under 35. People under 35 are the people who make change happen. I recently said that people over 45 basically die in terms of new ideas. Now, there's exceptions, and some of us who are over 45 try and keep having new ideas and stop falling back into old habits. It's very, very exciting. It keeps your life alive and new. But that's what I'm going to talk about. It's very easy to be cynical. It's easy to talk about why things are hard and why certain things won't happen. Amar mentioned FailCon. In the last decade, there is only one time I've called a conference and said, I'd like to speak. I get probably a few hundred requests to speak. Maybe for more than 500. And I have to unfortunately turn down most of them. But FailCon was the one time in the last decade I called somebody and said, I'd like to speak at this conference about failure. Because it is the essence to change. Instead of being cynical, if you can be optimistic and imagine the future you want, there's a pretty good chance you can create it. I like to say my willingness to fail is what gives me the ability to succeed. And I'll talk more about that. But let me go on to this issue of $750 billion and can it be done? Because the Indian economy is not that large in terms of total GDP. It was in the late 90s that I gave a similar talk at a software conference in New Delhi. In fact, it may even have been organized by NASSCOM, I don't remember. And I said, software is not really the opportunity, it's services. And services is an opportunity that's 10 times larger. It was hard to convince people. In 2000, in New Delhi, I chaired a three-day telecommunications session that McKinsey ran for all telecom operators in India, or all people interested. It's hard to imagine. It was only 10 years ago, and I remember Mukesh Ambani was sitting in the front row looking at how to look at this new business. It was hard to convince people landlines were not going to be the principal paradigm. I was wrong. I actually thought voice over IP would be the principal paradigm and then move to mobile. It's moved to mobile very rapidly. So the question is, what's next? And I think that's one of the more important questions we have. The message I want to give you from the last slide is large shifts happen all the time. It was hard in 1985 to imagine a PC in every home. When we were starting Sun, our competitor was Digital Equipment Corporation, the second largest computer company in the world, and their CEO said, why would anybody want a computer in every home? 5 years later, the second largest computer company in the world didn't exist. They were sold to Compaq. In 1990, people couldn't imagine email. I remember my friends laughed at me for having my email address in my business card, which I've had since 1982. 95, every major telecommunications company told me they would never, never do internet technologies in the telecom network, at the core of the telecom network. So you get the point. Large shifts happen all the time. This clicker is not working very well. I want to talk about one large shift, because it seems hard to imagine if India's economy is, pick a number, 2 trillion or something, to have 750 billion of it be in software services. This is an article from the New York Times that says 650 million people in India have access to cell phones. But the more interesting thing is only 350 million people have access to toilets. So there are 300 million people in this country who prefer to pay for cell phones over toilets. Which expert would have predicted that? They'd be laughed out of the room. But it is because large changes happen all the time. And it is because of changes like that that I believe we can reinvent the country. We won't grow to be 750 billion of a $2 trillion economy. But we can drive the economy and make the economy whatever larger, so software can be 750 billion. We will not be a part of the economy, we will lead the economy, and it can be done. And cell phones and toilets is just one example. The thing to remember is you can't do large things. Large changes are unreasonable, and you can't do unreasonable things by being reasonable. You have to be unreasonable. But there are experts who will tell you it can't be done. And my main message to you as entrepreneurs, especially all of you under 35, but everybody can be under 35. I'm 56 and consider myself under 35. That I ignore the experts when they tell me what can't be done. If we have time, we'll talk about it, but I'm going to leave room for questions. This was the president of the Royal Society only a few years before the Wright brothers flew the first plane. AT&T thought the telephone had too many shortcomings to be a means of communication, or Western Union, the precursor to AT&T. I've talked about the CEO of DEC. There's so many experts. But there is so much conventional wisdom that's wrong. Most of us have children. When they fall sick, get a temperature, what do? We give them aspirin or something, Tylenol, to bring their fever down. It's conventional wisdom in medical practice. The fact is, everybody accepts it. Nobody's challenged it. There was a study done at the University of Florida to say, what if we didn't reduce the fever for critically ill patients? The results were so compelling that it did not make sense to reduce fever, that they had to halt the study and change protocol for all patients. This is the single most accepted practice for hundreds of years in medicine. Somebody has high fever, bring it down. Yet it was wrong. People still mostly do it. My point is, ignore the experts. Forget extrapolating the past, and let's invent the future we want. I'll keep coming back to this theme. Here are, and I'm going through this very quickly, a 1978 projection of total bandwidth required in the United States to meet communications needs, 1980. You get the point. These are all projections experts make based on their set of assumptions. The actual amount of bandwidth that was needed was that. You notice they kept projecting the same flattening curve. We did an 8x in the 90s. We did a 9x in the between 2000 and 2010, but we'll only do 3x in the next decade. In fact, if we invent the future we want, we can have a similar thing. And this is forecast when every expert was wrong every year, year after year. The same thing happens in other areas. Boy, this is not working. I'm going to skip this slide in the interest. This was a forecast on the price of oil 5 years out. You can see how wrong they were. Unfortunately, can we do something about this? I'm going to skip through this. These are 5 and 10 year out forecasts of the price of oil done in 1985 first, 1990. This is not working very well. You can see every year, every 5 years when they make the forecast, people are very far wrong. In fact, today the price of oil is at $90 off this chart. My favorite, and this is the crux of why all of you can change the future. McKinsey was asked in 1986 to forecast the number of cell phones in the United States in the year 2000. They made a forecast for just under 1 million phones. The actual number was 109 million. They were off by a factor of 100 or more, 10,000%. So I asked myself the question, why were they so far wrong? This is only 14 years. For some reason, this clicker isn't working. Okay, thank you. Okay. Okay. So I asked myself why they were wrong, if this works. Okay, this was the phone in 1980s. I had one of these in 1986. This was the phone in the year 2000. They were trying to forecast something, a phone that would be smaller than the handset cord on the mobile phone that existed in 1986. If they couldn't make that technology forecast, they couldn't possibly make a forecast on the number of phones. If it looked like the one on the left, you wouldn't carry 109 million on your phone. I carry two in my pocket. I couldn't carry two of those. The point is, technology drives these markets. It's not extrapolation of past. And that technology forecast was impossible to make in 1986. That the batteries would be so much better, that microprocessors would take so much less power, that memory could be packed in so tightly. And of course, we know that, boy, I'm still having trouble with this. These are usually RF. Which way am I supposed to point? Okay. Yeah, it's not working very well. Now my phone has a dual processor and X gigabytes of memory, and there's hundreds of thousands of applications running on it. So my favorite is Professor Tetlock did a study of hundreds of experts across 20 years and 80,000 forecasts. You get the point I'm trying to make. The average results, Professor Tetlock is at Berkeley, about the same. Experts are as good as forecasting the future as dart-throwing monkeys. This is statistically valid data. Those of you who are statistically inclined, it's a book called Expert Political Judgment, but it covers a lot more than politics and economics. So, again, we can create this illusion of knowing by looking at all these forecasts that DataQuest and others put out, or we can just decide we don't know. We'll jump in and try things and try new things and make new things happen. And the rate of change is accelerating, which means the rate at which new things will happen will increase, which is good news for all of you trying to start companies and doing products. So I looked at the India scene, and it was interesting to see there's good companies happening. And I like the forecast that Sharad made of a $1 billion company every year. I actually believe it will happen. But so far, mostly these are extensions of what has happened in the West. I'd like to see things that are inventing whole new paradigms in India. The Indian market is 1 billion people. The US market is only a few hundred million people. The US market is pretty well filled out and competitive. The Indian market is the great opportunity. And right behind the Indian market is lots of other developing country markets where GDP is changing rapidly. So, I want to leave time for questions. So I'll go through these quickly without going through all of them. My point is there are a lot of areas that are still not addressed. And each one is an opportunity for a product. These are some of the consumer ones, and I'll talk about my favorite ones in just a minute. But it's also true in the enterprise, for those of you working on the enterprise side. This CUDA supercomputers is very, very interesting. For example, somebody I know built a 5 teraflop computing machine by using NVIDIA graphics chips for low-end graphics. Cost less than $25,000 and is now using it for one of the most sophisticated cybersecurity applications to keep security high in enterprises. These are the kinds of unusual things that matter. We've just invested in a new router company in 2011. Something people can't imagine. A new computer company, a new architecture for computers. Of course, security. And one of my most exciting areas is big data and unstructured data. So many opportunities to do new things. There's still many areas not done. And so lots of room for all of you, and I'll talk about some of these in a little more detail. What's even more exciting is all these opportunities are accelerating because there's broader access, There's new platforms. We've been locked in this PC platform for a long time. With tablets and phones, there's a whole new pair of post-PC era that'll have a whole new class of applications and whole new opportunities for new products. There's new behaviors. Twitter wasn't a behavior that existed 5 years ago. Neither was Facebook. Technology is being driven by consumer technologies. So this example of building supercomputers from graphics chips for PCs is new. Economic efficiency is going up, and this anytime. So let me talk about a dozen areas in the consumer marketplace that I actually think are really, really exciting. The internet for the last decade or 15 years has been expanding the amount of data. I think there's huge opportunity in reducing the amount of data. A couple of startups, these are not investments we've made, but I just found them on the web. Exciting ideas of what I mean. Big data I've talked about. BillGuard is interesting. It looks at lots of people's credit cards, and by looking across multiple credit cards, it tells each person what might be a fraudulent charge on your bill. Most people don't have the patience to go through every item on their credit card bill. This does this. Emotion, doing products for emotion, is an area that web startups have not done. Food spotting and Nest, you look at these applications, and I won't describe them. You feel something in your stomach and your heart. There will be many more emotional startups that appeal to not the utility side. I'll save you money or get you a job, like Naukri. It'll be, I'll make you feel good. I'll make you feel engaged as if you're telling a story or playing a video game. I think education will change. I'll come back and talk about this again. At least in the US, 60% of the people who watch TV have a second screen in their lap, either their computer or their phone or their tablet. And they're doing something on that tablet. There will be applications on that tablet that relate to what you're watching on TV. Facebook is just the beginning. Again, I wish I had time, but there's what I call social next. The next generation of social applications. And it'll be far bigger, I believe, than what Facebook is today. So far, social has been about your friends. Who do you like to talk to? Interest graphs are, what are you interested in? If I'm interested in stamp collecting or antiques, that's a different social graph than your friends. It's an interest graph. Health is a great idea. I think the nature of health will change dramatically. I wear this little band on my arm. This thing keeps track of how well I sleep. I plug it into my iPhone jack, the audio jack on my iPhone tells me every morning how well I slept, how many hours of deep sleep I had, light sleep, and how long I stayed awake in bed, how many steps I took yesterday, and soon it'll measure my blood pressure and everything else and tell me constantly how I'm doing. I'll come back and talk about NFC because I've seen a lot of skepticism about NFC, and I'll come back and address this. There's also the democratization of publishing. Not sure we need editors anymore. We don't need the gates that a Times of India or an Economic Times or a Hindustan Times puts on us, or the New York Times. Utility is still going to happen, useful products. If we have time, I'll go into Weatherbill because it's one of the most important insurance products I've seen. It's a company we invested in. did zero last year, about half a million in revenue last year, did about 30 million this year, and will double or triple next year. All it is a IT insurance product. There's a young kid, about 23 or so, started a company at a hack hotel in Bangalore called Interview Street, creating a new marketplace for employment for IT professionals. Already, Facebook and Twitter and Amazon are using his service. He's been in business for months, only a few months. Exciting idea. And then there's all kinds of exciting ideas that I won't go into, but I'll give you one or two examples. Mind Googling. This was an article in The Economist last week. Things that read your mind and do what you mean to say. It's a very interesting article. I don't have enough time, but there's examples of people flying remote helicopters by just thinking about it without being in the helicopter. That sounds pretty out there, but it's becoming reality. There's forecasts, time stoppers, which tell you where the next mugging or crime will happen, predicting the location of the next crime before it happens, a big data application. These kinds of exciting things will happen. What happened to the screen here? So the question I was asked is, has the time for original product development companies? And I added, beyond outsourcing, beyond Western markets, that means replicating an Amazon or replicating at monster.com, and beyond the small shifts. Healthcare is a large problem, probably one of the largest needs. It will be a $100 billion market, if not $300 billion market in India within some short period of time. How do we get more doctors? And I was asked, it's a big problem. And I said, every big problem is a big opportunity. So what if we decided we didn't need doctors to do healthcare? I now believe your health diagnosis will be delivered through your cell phone, diagnosis done by a computer using data like this. And your doctor may become a mentor or a coach if you have one. If you don't have one, it's still okay. I could imagine artificial intelligence and machine learning systems that can do this. In fact, IBM's using the Watson computer, which competed on the Jeopardy competition, which was supposed to be impossible for a computer to crack and beat out every other person, is now being applied to healthcare diagnosis. So I could see healthcare changing completely. Imagine a startup opportunity that's bigger than Facebook. The same thing can happen. In fact, I now believe the best education will happen without teachers. So maybe we don't need teachers to teach. We just need systems to learn. Even shopping could change. When I go to a store, and I say, oh, I want this particular shirt or dress, and they don't have my size because they can only stock 8 sizes, and only in 4 colors or 6 colors, but they don't have enough stock, and then they have to have enough of each. Maybe it's just an NFC tag you scan and the thing gets delivered to your home. So you just need display, you don't need inventory at a store. There's just one example. I can think of 100. I gave you one example of what Interview Street is doing with talent. I was talking to the people at Baba Job. Awesome opportunity to create a whole new class of marketplace for employment and talent. The cash economy, lots of interesting things happening. But I think what we will see is what has happened in Kenya, which is in a short period of time, mostly because the government ignored it, 20% of the GDP is now on M-Pesa, the mobile payments network. Whether the government likes it or not, it is going to happen. It's going to happen long before 2020. And it'll be a great opportunity. A lot of skepticism about UIDAI. But let me just suggest that this is a new capability as important as building railroads in the country or having air traffic. If air traffic is growing 25% a year because it's a basic fundamental utility, UIDAI identity can be as valuable a utility. By itself, nobody needs it. The hundreds of applications that can be built on it could dramatically change the structure of how business is done, how people behave, and what happens in the whole country. I suspect this is one of the most important new trends that won't be visible till 2020, but there will be lots of startups there. So I looked at, if you had secure NFC and these little things called QR codes, because not everybody has NFC readers, and UIDAI style infrastructure, the number of opportunities, I'm gonna stop here because I want to leave time for questions. So let me stop by saying, let me cover a few more slides very quickly. That sun was impossible to imagine, especially for a couple of 25-year-olds. I was 25. People said, why don't you just build graphics terminals to add on to deck VAXes? We said, no, we'll just go change deck. Can we have the slides back? When we started Juniper, 1995, every major telecommunications carrier in the world told me we will never use internet protocols, and we were designing a public router for internet protocols for public networks. 12 years ago, I was on the board of a company called Excite. I made an arrangement for Larry and Sergey to sell Google to them for a few $100,000. They didn't want to buy it because they couldn't imagine the future of why search would be that important. People had already done it. In energy, reinventing every part of energy. I won't go into the presentation here, but no question, every light will take 75% less electricity. I suspect, though yet I don't know how to do it, every air conditioner will take 75% less energy. Engines will take half the oil they consume today, whether it's your car or your truck. And you can see generating these dramatically differently. But most likely, it won't be these incremental things like the next solar cell or the next wind. It'll be something we haven't thought about. That's what innovation is about, surprises. It's why John F. Kennedy said, only those who dare fail greatly will achieve greatly. And my encouragement to you is try and fail, but don't fail to try something. Try, and if you fail, it's okay. This is something I like to say, I succeed only because I'm willing to fail. And I don't mind failing. It never embarrasses me. It embarrasses too many people. And so it restricts their ability to succeed. But I don't want to succeed by reducing risk to the point where the consequences of failure are small, of success are small. I don't mind failing, but if I do succeed, it better be worth succeeding. It better worth change something very, very large. I don't mind attempting to make oil and replacing crude oil, but if I succeed, I don't want 1% of the market. I want all of the oil in the world replaced with a renewable oil. I don't want small steps. I want large steps. So that's what taking risk is about. I always say you can only lose one times your money. But in a startup, especially a product startup, this is why product startups are so important, you can make 100 times your money. So I'll lose one times my money all the time. I know it's not an attitude investors take. But you can't succeed unless you're passionate about what you're doing. If you're doing it just to make money, it's very hard to succeed, because when you run into problems, you give up if you're not passionate. If it's your religion, you don't abandon your religion when you run into problems. If your product is your religion, then you'll be passionate. You'll have lots of fear, lots of times you'll be scared. But without being scared, there is no courage. You have to have guts, arrogance, and a lot of irreverence for the experts I talked about earlier. When people tell you how the world is, you say, no, I'm going to change the rules. That's important in making products instead of fitting into other people's picture. The best way to win any game is to make your own rules. I can win every game if I can make the rules. And to start leading, to start thinking for yourself. So taking risk, much easier when you're younger. I saw this survey of startups, and 65% of the people were under 40. I suggest to you, or all of you over 40, that you can act like you're under 40. There's all these charts and data points, and I say ignore them. Ask why people are presenting them. Every disadvantage I see in India, I look at as an opportunity to do something large. Again, every problem is an opportunity. All these problems. So let me finish by saying we give too much credibility to MNCs, big corporations, governments. They're largely irrelevant in the business of innovation. You can get Airtel as a huge partner for your mobile startup. I suspect it'll be great for your ego, you'll get a lot of press, and they won't do much to help you. What you do by yourself will be a lot more powerful. And if you're working at a company that's attractive like Google and Facebook, you're probably not going to do much. You're not going to make much of a difference. If you start your own company, start the next big idea, you'll make a huge difference. So let me just stop there and take questions. My email address is up there. Please raise your hands and maybe we can get a mic to you. If you need to email me, I read all my email. Sometimes I'm a month behind. We started Sun. It's been written about hundreds of thousands of times since we started it 30 years ago. We also, 3 months before we started Sun, we started a company, myself and Scott McNeely, called Datadog that died right away. Guess what? How many people have ever heard of it? Failure doesn't matter. Nobody remembers it. Success gets repeated. And guess what? We lost one times our money on data dump, and we made many times our money on Sun. That's the whole paradigm. I ignore failure. I accept it. I don't like failing. I always learn as much as I can from it. I ask a lot of questions, but I move on. Next question. Yes, let's go over there. Why don't you shout out the question and I'll repeat it.
What do you think is the future for outsourced online content creation and how to leverage content creators and things like that?
The question is, what do I think of outsourced content creation? Let me just say, I think in this new world, entertainment, which is tied to emotion, is going to be a big, big business. I suspect it won't be your normal thing of your cable channels. My bet is every single person, this is a great example of an opportunity, that you can outsource content creation and it'll be a good business. But it'll be what I call a linear business. Lots of it created, people will pay to create it. But what if you did the content directory? That means for every person, you knew what kind of programming they like and created a personal list of programs they want to watch. So wherever they were, whether on their TV or their cell phone or their tablet, they got a prioritized list of entertainment that they could see. That's a much more exciting business to me. It's not linear. It's not a repeat of what others are doing. It's brand new. So that's an example of the difference between what I call linear products, things that are obvious today, which there's a good market for, and there's a good market for Amazon here and Flipkart here, or Naukri here, or Monster.com here. But there are even more exciting markets if we think outside the box. And I suspect most of the billion-dollar companies that will be created in India will include new categories within a few years, categories that are original to India. Next question.
Right here. Let's.
Yes. So the question, I'll repeat it, is she's an organizational psychologist. Yeah. How do you go beyond your immediate network to find people that are complementary? When you work, you find people similar to you around you. It is really important to get a diverse set of people. And on my website at coastalventures.com under entrepreneurial resources, I wrote a paper this summer called Gene Pool Engineering. How do you engineer the gene pool of a company? I wrote a companion paper called Recruiting. How do you actually interview and recruit somebody? And those are meant mostly for entrepreneurs. I write a lot mostly to try and share this stuff with people. But first, it's important to realize you need people different than you in your startup, people who are thinking about the world differently and bring different biases into the company. But there's no substitute for time. I'll just say when we were starting Sun, I was asked this question last night by an entrepreneur. I spent 40% of my time recruiting. I said, which kind of experience would be good to get into my company? And let's say I needed salespeople I didn't know. Then I say, who had the best sales force? The answer was, in my time in Data General, I called every sales office, asked for every sales guy, and I literally had a map of every district managed sales manager they had. And then I just started calling them to start recruiting. I spent 40% of my time as CEO of Sun recruiting. I was just a glorified recruiter. Yeah, yes, let's go back there.
Why is the world behind the numbers? Why the world is only behind the numbers?
I'm not sure I followed the question.
Why the world is behind the numbers? Maybe in terms of revenue, the team size and everything. The first part of your presentation was regarding the capping of 4 billion revenue. Why is it not about anything other than the...
It is. I'm glad you raised that. If you put up my slides again, please just bring the slides back up. I skipped over a slide. Yes. I think it's important to know why you're starting a company, if you're starting a company. And I'm glad you brought this up. I sort of say, maybe you want to make a fortune, and your goal is never to balance your checkbook. You have enough money where you don't worry about it. But it could be It's you just want freedom to work for yourself. You don't want a boss. Perfectly acceptable reason. And never having to say you're sorry because you're the boss. It could be fame. It could be like, I want to be like Mark Zuckerberg and Bill Gates and everybody listens to me. It could be your passion for the product vision you're trying to do. I just want to change the world in this particular way. Or I just want to work with friends. Any one of these is an acceptable goal for an entrepreneur. I think what goes wrong is when people don't know why they're starting their company. And they mix objectives. But I'm glad you raised the question. Let's go over there since we haven't asked that side.
You want to ignore experts, and sometimes you want to ignore market research also, right? Like in case of Juniper.
Could you speak up a little bit? I can't hear you.
You want to ignore experts. Mm-hmm. You also want to ignore market research as in case of Juniper Networks, right? But when you get an idea, how do you get conviction that you should work on it actually?
You know, there's a good book called On Being Certain. How do you get certainty about something written by a neuroscientist? It's one of my favorite new books. And it talks about entrepreneurs and risk-taking and how you convince yourself to take risk. Some people are genetically inclined to believe things. Turns out, believing in ideas you get and taking the risks associated with it is the same genes that makes you believe in religion, because you're willing to believe something without proof. It is just a part of entrepreneurship that you get conviction about what you're trying to do, and once you do, you then jump into it almost like it's your religion. I don't have a suggestion for people who don't believe their own ideas. I think it's really, you have to have conviction about what you're doing. But at the same time, you have to read this other book, which is also one of my favorite books, written by the founder of Intel, Andy Grove, Only the Paranoid Survive. So I say you have to have schizophrenia about this combination of arrogance and overconfidence in what you can do, and paranoia about everything that can go wrong. And if you can sort of do both in the same person at the same time, you'll have a more successful startup. Thank you, everybody.
Well, thank you.
Just Vinod will be here most of the day. He's running another session. It's not really a session. It's a fireside chat format. You'll see that in your handout for later this afternoon. And so you'll have more time with him at the next session. We just want to acknowledge Vinod. We invited him. He came all the way from the Bay Area, so we have something special for him to take home. Vinod?
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinod.
Thank you, everybody.